looking at events or issues in Dun Laoghaire-Rathdown in this month's council meeting. But first, speaking of Dun Laoghaire-Rathdown, we have a candidate from that part of the world in studio today. Her name is Deirdre Kingston of Labour. And Mick Fitz, it's over to you.
Well, straight from her performance at the Labour Party conference, which drew lots of praise. Deirdre, welcome to Council Matters.
Thank you very much. It's lovely to be here.
Deirdre, you're a new name in the political environment. Tell us, who's Deirdre Kingston? Where are you coming from? We know you're from the Blackrock area, but who is the person?
Well, I'm 31 years old, so relatively young, I like to think. Yeah. And I studied in UCC. I studied politics in UCC. So I guess politics has always been a part of my life, really. And I've been living in Dublin for the last 10 years. Mm-hmm. I studied in DCU as well, did a master's there. And at the moment, I'm working for Goethe. They're a development agency, overseas development. I work there part-time, and I work in the Oireachtas as well for a TD. So I help constituents with different matters and housing issues, social welfare issues, that kind of thing, and try and kind of guide them through the bureaucracy, I suppose, is a way of looking at it. And yeah, so I'm from West Cork originally, actually. So I settled in Dublin about 10 years ago. So,
looking at that, Deirdre, just the line from West Cork to Blackrock.
Yeah.
I mean, these are fabulous areas. That's all I can say. These are parts of the world that 90% of the world would just love to live in. I mean, how does that equip you for the Labour Party?
Well, they are, you're right. I mean, they are fabulous places to live, you know, coastal towns. People have their problems there as well. You know, they're beautiful places, but, there are issues, and the Labour Party is very strong in Blackrock. We've had a very strong representative there for the last number of years in Councillor Niamh Breathnach. Mm-hmm. And I think it's very important always to have a Labour presence in every community, because Labour is always kind of fighting for, you know, fairness and equality. Mm-hmm. And no matter where you are, you need that representation, I think.
Mm-hmm. What I was saying before we came on here, looking at this election, I'm seeing this as a very different election to particularly previous local government elections. To me, this is the first election, particularly in Ireland, of the internet age. Last time round, we didn't have Facebook, we didn't have Twitter, we didn't have social networks that we do have now. How much has that fed into your thinking, and particularly how you try and get your message out there? Because clearly you've got DNA, your politics and your DNA. How do you see this? Do you see it as a threat or an opportunity?
Well, the online thing, I mean, it's definitely a huge part of every campaign, I think. A lot of my colleagues in the Labour Party that are the new generation, say, of politicians, they are using Facebook and Twitter, and it's very handy, I suppose, to get your message across immediately. Mm-hmm. And if you have a response to something, you can get it out immediately online. But in saying that, I mean, the most important thing for somebody who is running a local campaign is to get out knocking on doors and get out and meet people face to face, talk to them one on one, spend a bit of time around the doors so that you get to know what their everyday issues are, what their local issues are. And while I think Facebook and Twitter and all of those things complement that very well, ultimately it's about getting out and it's about meeting people, you know, because you are there to represent them, so you have to understand what makes them tick, I suppose.
Have we gone beyond Rory Quinn's statement in the last one that Dylan Haskins had more Facebook friends than votes? I've always said that one might come back to haunt the Labour Party. Is there a danger that some internet campaign could come along that we've never seen it before? I mean, we are in unprecedented times. And is that a danger for you guys?
Well, I don't think it's a danger. I mean, absolutely, anybody can enter the race. Mm-hmm. And that's the great thing about Irish politics, is that, you know, a candidate can stand up, say, an independent candidate, and enter the race and run whatever campaign they want to do. But I think ultimately, the people who are voting for you want to have met you. Mm-hmm. And they want to have spent that time with you and shook your hand and looked at your eyes and said, OK, well, why do you want me to vote for you? And you have to have that interaction with people, I think, to make an impression on them. And they have to be aware that you are going to be there for them. I mean, if I ran a campaign just on Facebook, who's to know that I was even living in Booterstown, you know?
Mm-hmm. We all saw you on YouTube. I mean, nearly 500 people saw you on YouTube. If every one of those voted for you, I bet you'd take it.
Yeah, absolutely. I'd take every vote I could get, believe me. But no, I mean, you have to do these things. And, you know, the Labour Party conference was a great opportunity for me to stand up and talk about something that, you know, it's a very serious issue. I mean, the environment, you can't get more serious than that. Mm-hmm. And it was a great platform for me. And, you know, I did get great feedback from it. And there was
it was a great performance.
Yeah, and that's what I'm saying. It's important to have those vehicles, I suppose, to complement your campaign. You know, you have to kind of take these opportunities.
And I don't want to labour this point, when you say that meeting people and shaking hands, and we leave out the kissing of the babies.
Yeah.
Isn't that a certain demographic? Are you almost assuming that young people won't vote in that sense of the word? Because I suspect young people don't really want to be dragged away from the telly to talk to some politician at the door. I'm just wondering, have we perhaps reached the limit of that style of campaigning?
I don't think so. You know, I mean, when I've been out canvassing now, you know, most weeks, a couple of nights a week, and in general, you know, you're meeting a huge variety of age groups, but you're also meeting a lot of young people. Like, for instance, last week, I was chatting to a mother on the door, and she said her son had just turned 18 and he was dying to talk to a candidate.
Yeah.
So he came out to the door and I had a lovely conversation with him, and he was really excited about voting for the first time, and he hadn't registered, so I was able to, you know, send him the voter registration form. So you have a huge variety of ages, and you know, it was really encouraging to speak to somebody like that, because he wasn't kind of negative towards politicians or anything like that. He was genuinely excited about it. So
one of the things that's interesting again is the number of women who are running in this election. I mean, yours is one of the highest constituencies.
Yeah.
I think there's 6 women registered candidates. And I think there's the Labour Party are pretty close to about 30%.
Yeah.
Is the woman vote important to you?
Absolutely. I mean, you know, I think females appreciate a young woman standing at the door and having a chat with them. I think we need to see more women in politics, 100%. The Labour Party have always been very good in terms of encouraging women to participate in politics, but also to represent. In other political parties, I think you see women participating, but you don't have that encouragement to go forward. And it is changing a little bit, but I'm extremely proud to be running, I suppose, for the Labour Party because of their good record of female participation. But yes, I mean, women are incredibly important. I mean, they are a very discerning voter, and I think they like to see, you know, their own gender represented. So, yeah.
30% though, I mean, would you favour quotas? Because that would get you up to 50%. But 30%, do we do it gradually, or how do you feel about it?
It is that gradual sense. I do think we needed quotas, and the idea to link it to political funding, I think, is a good one, because it encourages political parties to look within themselves and say, OK, what has been hindering women so far and how can we change that? And I think the quotas needed to be done just to break that barrier, you know. And I think once other women see women running, and women in councils and women in the Dáil, then it gets that little bit easier. I mean, they say that, you know, cash, confidence, childcare, they have the 5 C's that, you know, stop women from running for politics. And I think, you know, as more and more women get onto councils and into the Dáil, those things will be addressed, because you need women to address those issues. So.
Now, Deirdre, I'm going to have to tell you I'm disappointed. And do you know why I'm disappointed?
Tell me.
Now, although you're very stylishly dressed, I was hoping you would be wearing I'm on a team panty t-shirt.
Oh, I actually have one.
I know you have. But now, here's my question then. If you came to our door, you would probably get 3 votes. However, if you went round to David Quinn, who lives around the corner, you might lose 2. Isn't that the calculation that people do? Because, I mean, I'm assuming it's a political rather than a fashion statement, although it was a great fashion statement.
Yeah.
But isn't that the danger by people react to symbols rather than what we would call values?
Yeah, well, I think, I mean, you say that, you know, there's a danger that you go to one house and get support and one house you might not get any support, but you have to stand up for what's true to yourself, you know what I mean? And, I mean, that is something that, you know, it really is a serious issue in Ireland. I mean, the way, you know, homophobia has been present in our culture for a long time. And I think if I can be a part of making a stand, if I can make people stand up and take notice, like, for instance, us discussing it here today, that's very important. If it'll lose me votes, well, so be it. I mean, that's my opinion on things. And I think people respect people having a strong opinion and standing up for what they believe in.
Yeah. Before I get criticised, I'm going to say Rory is a friend of mine, so I'm not going to appear to be partisan. But one of the issues that struck me about that whole controversy, and I'm not going to go into whether I own institutes, good, bad or indifferent, it was the performance, is the way I will put it, of RTE, that they seem to come to a decision, a contentious decision, very, very quickly.
Yeah.
How did you feel, you know, when you saw the way that whole episode panned out?
I agree. I think that RTE came to a decision very, very quickly, and probably too quickly for my liking. You know, they probably needed to think a little bit more about you know, the consequences of that quick decision. I know they probably received legal advice. They said that they received, you know, very good legal advice, etc. But I think, you know, especially when we have a referendum next year, you don't want anything to stifle debate on this. And you don't want anybody to be afraid to speak out. It needs to be an open debate. And I think what Rory said on that Brendan O'Connor show was something that he had experienced, and it was his position on it and, you know, how he felt. And that's very important, because ultimately this is what this is about. It's what people have experienced in our culture over the last number of years. So to answer your question, yes, I think the decision was made very, very quickly. But, you know, they received legal advice. And
is there a danger we get money politics playing in? Because that's essentially what we had in that instance, was money politics. Well-funded organisations were able to have their voice heard, whether their voice was valid or otherwise.
Yeah. Oh, I think there will probably be a lot of money poured into the referendum campaign, certainly from different sides. But, you know, ultimately, I mean, the Irish people will go to the polls. There's going to be nobody influencing their vote when they're in there in the ballot box. You know, it's just them and their voting paper. And I think we have progressed as a nation. I think the attitude of people has changed. I think young people are going to be very engaged in this referendum, and they are going to be key. And I think that will win through in the end, absolutely.
And there's no danger to the standing of the traditional Irish family?
No, I don't think so. I think once you have two parents that love you as a child, that's all that matters.
It'd be an interesting debate, won't it?
It will, absolutely. Yeah.
Let's move on, Deirdre. I mean, one of the issues that's going to loom large, and I gather from what I'm hearing, that Dun Laoghaire-Rathdown are in favour of a referendum on a directly elected Lord Mayor. What's your thoughts on that?
Yeah, they are leaning towards it. I don't think they have discussed it as a council, but they are absolutely leaning towards supporting it going to the people. I heard there a couple of days ago that Fingal County Council were against the proposal to put it to the people. I was a bit disappointed with that, I have to say. I'm in favour of a directly elected mayor, but I think it has to have, you know, substantial powers as well. But I think ultimately it should go to the people on the 23rd of May and ask them what they want, rather than the four councils deciding.
What sort of powers would you like that directly elected Lord Mayor to have?
Well, I think it needs to have, you know, a strategic view of the county and city as a whole. And that should include, you know, transport, and it should include environment issues and, you know, waste and stuff like that. So, you know, I think it needs to be strategic more than anything, and work in conjunction then with the councils. But I think, you know, we need a strategic view of Dublin in the long term.
Doesn't that then become a challenge to central government? That would tend to always be the dichotomy of government in Ireland, that Dublin was the only real, no disrespect to Cork, but Dublin was really the only challenge to central government. And the more you go one way, it almost becomes regional government. Would you be concerned about that?
No, I think, I mean, there's a lot of issues I think we have to work out in terms of the position of mayor. But I think you can work alongside each other. I mean, yeah, you know, there is the argument that Dublin takes a lot of resources, but there is a lot of people living here, you know, and there is a lot of money coming from people in the area, and they need to see the benefits of that funding as well. So I think you just need to find a situation where central government can work in harmony with the new office. Mm-hmm. And, you know, of course you can have that. You mean you can have regular meetings and good representation from the office of the mayor. So.
Mm-hmm. Now, I know that the only poll that matters is the one on the 23rd. The opinion polls are saying that the Labour Party is going to be blamed for a lot of what people don't like about government. A, do you think that's true? And if it is, do you think it's fair?
Well, when you say it is true, I think local elections are very different. You know, yes, the Labour Party have gotten some slack over the last number of years. Of course they have. I mean, the Labour Party came into government at, you know, a horrendously difficult time and had to make really hard decisions. But I think in terms of local elections, the people that I'm meeting, they, you know, they respect the work that the Labour councillors have done in the area. And I think, you know, the Labour councillors such as Niamh Breathnach, their record will show through in the local elections. I mean, people's opinion of the Labour Party, has it been damaged? Maybe in a sense, because these difficult decisions have been made. I don't think it's fair to answer your second question. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, it has to be seen in an overall context and what we were handed to when we came into government and what we have now done. I mean, you look at job numbers, we're now creating 7,000 jobs a month when we were losing so much back. We were losing, I think, about 5,000 back in 2009 every month. And they're concrete results, you know, and you can't ignore that. And I do think the party will be vindicated when it comes to the next general election, because we will be in a very healthy position economically and stability will have restored. But in terms of the 23rd of May, it's the local achievements that count. And I think Dun Laoghaire-Rathdown has done pretty well locally, you know. So.
Well, you've got a Labour Party mayor, don't you?
Yeah.
Anyway, let's have a look at the issues you've highlighted. Maximum reduction of 15% in the local property tax. Now, other people are going out there and saying, we'll get rid of it. Are they being unrealistic?
Yes, well, the property tax is there. And, you know, in fairness, the people of Dun Laoghaire-Rathdown have been, you know, incredibly supportive. They've been very compliant with it. I think 88% of households in the county have paid their property tax. But, you know, it is there. It has been signed into law. So what we have to do now is see how we can alleviate it for people. And house values in Blackrock and in Dun Laoghaire-Rathdown are quite high. And the Labour Party, as a party, have said in Dublin that they want to reduce it by the maximum of 15%. And I would be very much in support of that, but only because we can afford it. So Dun Laoghaire-Rathdown would take in, I think it's around about 36 million in the local property tax, and about 25 million from local government fund. So we can actually afford to cut it by the 15% and not see a cut in services, which is absolutely essential, because you don't want anybody in Booterstown or Blackrock or Dean's Grange or anywhere like that noticing a cut in services as a consequence of that reduction. So yeah, I would support it. I think, you know, any bit of alleviation would be
welcome. Would you see the tax itself as progressive? A progressive tax being that which hits the better off hardest and the lowest off? Or how do you see it as some form of tax neutral?
Yeah, well, I wouldn't see it as tax neutral. I think, you know, it is in most European countries at the moment. So it is, it's a difficult one to bring in, I suppose, especially at a time that was, you know, it was so tough financially and people were really feeling the effects of the recession. But I think, you know, it's fair in respect that it's linked to the value of the house. Mm-hmm. So you would hope that people that are living in mansions will pay that bit more, which they will. You know, if they're living in a house that's worth a lot of money, you can assume that they have a lot of money themselves and that they will be able to pay it.
People aren't necessarily, you can be asset rich and cash poor, that's the problem but as I say, if you're living in $1 million house, we'd probably all like to have that sort of problem.
Yeah, exactly.
Anyway. When I go around, particularly in these parts of the world, what I'm tending to see on the posters is an emotive appeal in the sense of oppose water charges. Now, I take a view that there's a cost somewhere down the track. The way I look on it is that my need is to turn on the tap and get clean, drinkable water reliably. Yeah. There is a cost to that. Are people perhaps not being dishonest, but being unrealistic when they're saying we can get rid of property tax or we can get rid of water charges without hampering services?
Absolutely. I mean, I would love to see the proposals for getting rid of these taxes and, you know, what will take their place. I mean, local government, it needs a level of funding, you know, in order to be able to survive, as does central government. And I think, you know, while they are difficult for people, the water charges, you know, it will be an adjustment for people, but there is going to be a set allowance that, you know, people won't be charged for a certain amount. But absolutely, I think it's an easy thing to jump on a bandwagon to put out these posters against water charges and property tax. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you have to have something to back it up. Where are you going to fill that gap?
Mm-hmm. The other things you're looking at here, generally, they're what we would call, they're not motions that people are going to generally oppose, like the Cycleway, which is, I think is a good idea, even if it's, you know, only is going to be used by small numbers of people. But what you're looking at then is improving the environment for business. Can a council do much in that area, Deirdre?
Yeah, well, absolutely. I mean, the council have provided a shop improvement fund for businesses in the area. So they're encouraging them to improve their shop front. There's grants available. And there is also an initiative in Dun Laoghaire where the council give vacant units over to small traders. Mm-hmm. And I'd like to see that extended to Blackrock as well. I think, you know, the council can create an environment for businesses to thrive. So if there's vacant units, there might be, you know, a proposal that new businesses coming in might see some kind of incentive to take a vacant unit, maybe commercial rates could, you know, be reduced for the first year or something like that. There's little things that the council can do to encourage businesses, absolutely. And, you know, in terms of the environment in Blackrock, there's some great independent businesses there like Blackrock Market and the bookstore and everything, Raven Books. But you need to, the council can create that environment that allow people to want to come into the community. Like, say, for example, I put into the local area plan that maybe we need to look at a street furniture plan in Blackrock. Mm-hmm. So that it encourages more people to come in and helps the business environment as a whole.
Well, Deirdre, Niamh is a hard act to follow, but she, as I say, she has anointed well. So we wish you the very best on the 23rd of May. So, Deirdre Kingston, thank
Great
you for your time
here.
Today.
You.
Over to you, Colin.
Thank